Thank you again, once more, for inviting me to this symposium in Madrid. I'm very happy to be here. I have to say that I have been here first and last time. It's in the last century. It was in 1968. And arriving from the airport to downtown and to the university campus, it's like jumping from the mid of 20th century into 21st century. Thank you very much for this invitation and that I have the opportunity to meet again colleagues, scholars I know since some time. I am talking about Kharkiv, a palimpsest of death, destruction, and memory. And I'm just back from Kiev and Kharkiv in last week. And it's a quite strange situation. This should be a talk about history, about the past, about disasters, catastrophes in the last generations. But this country, the Ukraine, and some cities of the Ukraine are entering a new disaster and are at the brink of a new war. So it's not only talking about the past, it's about the present time. And if I go to talk about the palimpsest, it's not only about past. The palimpsest is rewritten now, in this moment when we are meeting here. There are going on the preparations for the Victory Day. Other people call it the Day of Sorrow. And we do not know what will happen tomorrow or on the 8th and 9th of May. And in Kiev, for instance, the administration and the political establishment has decided to have 2 days, the 8th and the 9th of May. So it could be that there will be 2 manifestations, and I very, very hope that there will be no clashes in this war of memory about the interpretation of what has happened during World War II in the Ukraine. I have to tell that I'm not an expert on Ukraine history, but I was forced to go into Ukraine history, as most of the scholars of East European history. I was socialized academically in a kind of Russian-centric and Soviet-centric history. I was doing my study in Moscow and Leningrad, coming from West Germany. And I was forced, I have to say, thanks to Putin, to re-enter the field of East European, Russian, and Soviet history to get into what is Ukraine history. Mark von Hagen, an American scholar, about 10, 15 years ago, has asked, is there a Ukrainian history at all? And I had to learn that I do not know very much about Ukraine history, and I have to go back to the school benches, to lectures, and to read. And this I did since last year, since Maidan, and I have been there now several times, looking around what is going on. So the crisis, the so-called Ukrainian crisis, which is in fact imported crisis from outside under the pressure of Russian and especially Putin, has forced me to re-enter, and this is the framework and the general condition why I came to Kharkiv. I have been in Kharkiv, I have to say also, very early in the 60s when our school in West Germany, in Bavaria, organized a trip in 66 from Munich to Moscow, traveling from Vienna, Budapest, Mukachevo, Uzhgorod, Lemberg, Kiev, Kharkiv. So I have been in the 60s already in Kharkiv, and I never could imagine that this great and strong and powerful city would be sometime a place of contest or even the threat of civil war. There is literature, not very much literature about Kharkiv especially. We have some studies about Donbass by Hiroaki Kuroyama. We have some studies about Donbass during the German occupation by Tanya Penta and others. So there is not very much research and literature, and my main way to enter history and to go is not only to read the classical and canonic books, Orest Sapteľný and others, but to go to the place. I'm convinced, and I'm happy that I can join the views which has been pointed out here already, I'm convinced that history takes place. History is not only a series of events in a chronological order. History takes place on the spot, on the ground, on the site. And so the main instance or the main basis for proving and controlling is for me to go to the place. And so this was the reason why I went to Kiev, why I went to Donbass, why I went to Dnipropetrovsk, to Odessa, and other places to see what is going on and to read Time in Space. This is the title of the book, which has been translated to Spanish a couple of years ago. So to go to the place, to navigate the city, to explore in a kind of Benjaminian flânerie the place, and to decipher landscapes, buildings, facades, public spaces, monuments, etc. In this way, I'm joining Fernand Braudel, who liked to say that his main document is not the archive, but the Mediterranean Sea itself. For me, the main document in reading history are the places, in, and especially cities, and I've mostly written about cities and the urban space. There is, I'm just coming to the Kharkiv place, but I have to say some or one more word about the complexity and the specificity of entering Ukrainian history. Because if you go to Ukraine, you have already a palimpsest of different histories, because the territory of today, Ukraine, belonged to a couple of different empires, states. And if you want to try to understand what is the history of the Ukraine, of the political nation of the Ukraine today, you have to know this history. You have to know the foundation of the Kievan Rus in the Mid-Dnieper River region. You have to know that it belonged for three centuries to the Lithuanian and Polish realm, the kingdom. You have to know that the western part belonged for 200 years almost to the Habsburg Empire, that the center of East European Jewish history in the Pale of Settlement was mainly on the territory of today, Ukraine. You have to know that it has been for almost 300 years part of the Russian Empire and then of the Soviet Union. And especially in the 20th century, it has been the territory for the most cruel, brutal, and battle. It was one of the main battlefields of the 20th century. So going to Kharkiv, I'm sorry that I do not have pictures. It is not because I'm lazy and do not want to show to make this work. It has to do with my job, with my approach, with my way of reading cities. It is going, it's walking, days long, kilometers, going to places where usually people do not go. And my way is to describe, and I'm very sorry, because I have been on places where no of Western or German historians have been. But my way of presenting things is to describe them, and I will try to recreate in our imagination what I have seen, and I hope I will be successful in doing this. Kharkiv is the second city in Ukraine today. It's a 1.5 million city. It's a powerful city. It's a quite young, founded in the end of the 17th century, before there was a Cossack settlement. And it was the main hub in the south of the Russian Empire from in the 19th century. And it was the first capital of the Soviet Ukraine from 1919 up to 1934. I knew this city because it was a fascinating place for European architecture. In the 20s and in the first part, in the first half of the 30s, Kharkiv has been the main exhibition place of modern architecture, and they call it the Red Modern. The Red Modern, which has been built compounds, complexes, earlier, 10 years earlier than Rockefeller Center in 1925 to 1928, the complex of the house of the ministries, the house of the government, which is still existing there. It was the main place for reinventing Novy Kharkov, the new city, and it was a place where people were going to see what the new Soviet society should be. So I was fascinated mainly by these Bauhaus and constructivist architecture, and I would say European architects who never have been in Kharkiv, they do not know what is architecture in the 20th century. They have to go there. And I went to this, and it's not only the 20s and the early 30s, but also 19th century, because most architects and city planners of the capitals from St. Petersburg and Moscow came to Kharkiv to build in a large scale and unbelievable things. So it was the center of modernity, of a booming Ukrainian culture in the 20s and first half of the 30s, but at the same time, it is a city of suffering, a city of despair, a city of disasters. And I will try to just to tell you what the layers of these history are in the 20th century. And I did it when I was there last year and 2 weeks ago. Knowing and reading about this, you take a taxi and a cab and you are just driving around from one place to the other, and you get an idea what this city has lived through in the 20th century. And I will just mechanically number what these layers are. A First World War. For a long time, as you know, First World War never had been important or relevant for Soviet or Russian historiography and for Ukrainian historiography, because it was always in the shadow of the after events, that means the Russian Revolution and the Civil War. Nobody was interested in the mobilization of the deportations, in the mass mobilization and the destruction of caused by the First World War, and only now there's going on a rediscovery and reconsidering of what was the impact of First World War. And so in Kharkiv, in the urban museum, they were preparing the first exhibition on what impact had First World War on these, the biggest city in the south of the Russian Empire. So despite the fact that dozens of thousands people moved to the front, despite the fact that many institutions from western part of the Russian Empire were evacuated to Kharkiv and other places, it has not been done research on the impact of First World War. It was only the prehistory of the following events of the revolution and civil war. Second revolution and civil war. There are, of course, a number of so-called comrades or brothers graves, memorials for the heroes of the civil war. But what civil war meant for a city like Kharkiv is even up today still unexplored, and there has not been done much research. There has been about a dozen of changing rules between 1917 and 1920, and you had the independent Ukrainian government for a very short moment. You had the Bolsheviks coming to Kharkiv, taking power. You had afterwards the German occupation after the Brest-Litovsk Treaty for almost a year. There was a first German occupation from March to November 1918. You had the bandits, the social bandits, as Hobsbawm would call them, of Makhno and Grigoriev, the peasant war people, and you had the White Guard people from Denikin coming to Kharkiv, and all left their traces in the city. And it is much, it's not very known that in the consequence of the civil war and of the forced expropriation of grain, etc., from Ukrainian peasants, there was a great famine. There was not only the famine of 32 and 33, there was a famine as a consequence of civil war in 21, 20, 22, with about 1 million people who died from this. So there was a very short period of peaceful development, of recovery, the so-called new economic policy in the 20s, and this was a kind of the boom time for Kharkiv, but it was a very short time. It was already in the late 20s when the first show trials were staged, public show trials against representatives of the bourgeois nationalist intelligentsia, engineers, etc. Public trials but this was addressed to individuals. It was not terror on a mass scale. The main event, which is a trauma, I would say, is starting with collectivization in 1929. That means that hundreds of thousands of people from all over the Ukraine have been forcibly deported to the north, or they voluntarily or were forced to leave the countryside because there was no food and they were threatened with persecution. And Kharkiv was one of the centers of not only of forced collectivization, of suppression of the peasant risings and uprisings in the surrounding, but it was in the center, the epicenter of the Great Famine of 1932-33, with, as you know, in the whole of Ukraine, about 3.5 million people died, and the only place where starving countryside could get some bread and some food was to enter the city, but the city was closed from by NKVD troops, and they were forced to not to enter the city. We have about this quite good literature, memoirs, for instance, Viktor Kravchenko, who was a student at that time. We have the brilliant memoirs of Lev Kopylev, who was an exile, a Russian Jewish Ukrainian writer exiled in the 70s to West Germany. We have the memoirs of Petro Grigorenko, the general and later on dissident, a prominent dissident, and I was happy to meet him in his late years. And he was describing when he went as an activist, as a young communist, to the countryside to mobilize the collection of grain from the countryside. There's a very small section in the local museum about the collectivization. There are the tractors, the Ford tractors. There are some documents about cannibalism, about trials, what the Holodomor in fact is, you can see in another place, for instance, in the Holodomor Museum, the Central Museum in Kiev. There's a new museum established by Yushchenko in the 10 years ago or so. And there you can, among others, you can find dozens of so-called red books of the victims, of the martyrs of the Holodomor, with thousands, dozens of thousands, villages with address, names, the date of birth and death, the reason of why people died, etc. And you can stay there and read for days and weeks to go through the landscape of death, or as Robert Conquest has called it, the harvest of sorrow. Of the 30s. And Kharkiv has been an epicenter in this landscape of death. And if you take a taxi, you can go to the park, one of the parks in Kharkiv, where are some small hills. There's not a memory, there's an announcement there should be built a memorial, and you can take a taxi, go outside of the city to Piaty Chashki, which is a place, one of the villages which has been devastated and depopulated, and there's a great memorial at the junction from Kharkiv to Belgorod. So, Holodomor and the mass graves where people have been buried. You can go to these places on the territory of the city of Kharkiv. So the next layer would be the show trials against the bourgeois nationalists in 1935. After the end of the policy of Ukrainization, after the policy of the 20s, giving the Ukrainians their language, literature, and art, a national art, there was a counter-revolution under Stalin's in Stalin's time, starting with the killing of the national elite of writers, painters, of the Ukrainian avant-garde, which existed in the 20s, and this took place in 35 mainly. It was a wave of killings and suicides, even among the communist elite like Mykola Skripnik and others. The next layer would be 1937-38, the Great Terror, with also mass graves in downtown Kharkiv, on the place where in pre-revolutionary time has been the Jewish cemetery, then the park of the communist Jews, and in the 30s it was a place to bury people which have been killed in the prisons in Kharkiv, especially in Kholodnaya Gora, and in the prison of NKVD in Chernyshevskaya Ulitsa. About 17,000 have been killed systematically along these lists of the famous, infamous lists of July and August 1937. And we know now a lot about this wave of the Great Terror, because we have memoirs, for instance, of Alex Weisberg Cibulski, an Austrian Jew who moved to Kharkiv as an expert. He was a physic colleague of famous physics Joliot Curie, and he was imprisoned for 2 years in Kholodnaya Gora, and he was writing the best report which was published in the early 50s. He survived somehow. He described in detail what was going on in Kholodnaya Gora in these 2 years. It is one of the best reports we have. And the foreword is written by his friend Arthur Koestler, which is a person of the Spanish Civil War, as you know. For instance, one of the prominent people killed in and this is the next wave after the starting of the Second World War, which started not in 22nd of June 42, but which started in 1st of September 1939, and which was followed by the occupation of the eastern parts of Poland in 17th September of 1939, taking about 25,000 of Polish officers and representatives of the Polish elite, and some of them on the so-called Ukrainian list were moved to Kharkiv. And one of the officers was the father of Andrzej Wajda, the famous Polish regisseur, kinematographer, and he was killed in March of 1940. And one of the places you can see now in Kharkov, the prison of the NKVD, which is now an administrative building of the today Ukrainian internal ministry. And you can go out of the town to Belgorod Chosse, and there's a great memorial established by a joint enterprise by Ukrainian and Polish government, and this mass grave buried about 4,000 of Polish officers, among them the father of Andrzej Wajda. So we are entering now already Second World War, which was the most devastating experience Kharkiv was going through. And you can all over, it's not only in Kharkiv, it's almost in all former Soviet cities in the West, which have been occupied by the Wehrmacht and by the German terror commands, SS, etc. Almost in every institution, almost in every park, almost in every neighborhood of a former Soviet and today Ukrainian or Belarusian or Russian city, you can find small memorials, graves for people who have been killed during the war and the German occupation. It is in institutions, if you go to the Opera House, you find some memorialne doski, these plaketten. If you go to the university, I had a talk in the university. In the lobby of the university is a memorial for the professors, for the students fighting at the German against the Germans. So the entire territory of the city is punctuated with the traces of occupation and resistance, and these are very killing fields, you have to say. And the city of Kharkiv had, at the outbreak of the war in 1939, about 800,000 people. At the end of the occupation, there have been left 180,000. Dozens of thousands have been deported to Germany to work as forced laborers in the Reich. Dozens have been killed and starved. And the main thing, of course, is the fate of the Kharkiv Jewry, which was collectively already in December of 1941 collected in the former tractor factory, the tractor plant, the famous tractor plant of the first 5-year plan, the biggest tractor plant of the Soviet Union in the 30s. And this has become the ghetto where has been concentrated the Jewry of Kharkiv. And then step by step, they were moved outside to Drobnytsky Yar, which is not as famous as Babi Yar in Kiev, but which has the same story. About 20,000 Jews have been killed in Drobnytsky Yar outside the border of the city. There is a monument, a big monument, with the menorah, which with a memorial crypta, with some explanations of what was going on during the German occupation. And there's a small museum of Kharkiv Jewry established by a wonderful woman who since the early 90s has on their own established and constructed a wonderful and the only museum remembering the Jewish community. And there is a synagogue, the Choral Synagogue in Pushkinskaya Street, which is created by a famous Petersburg architect, and which has been a sports hall, and it survived only because it has been a sports facility. Otherwise, it would have been destroyed either by the German or by the post-war Soviet administration. On some buildings, for instance, at some prominent bank houses or communist administration buildings, you can see some photographs where people have been executed, and you can see some photographs with the gallows on the big places, the big squares, and along the main streets. So I'm finishing this and entering the post-war time. On this park of commemoration in the center of the city where I was walking around, there are more memorials. There are memorials for a very moderate memorial, and it was vandalized several times for people from the Ukrainian Resistance Army or the Ukrainian National Movement, the UN or the UPA, which took up arms to fight against the comeback of the Red Army and the Soviet power. And this struggle in the eastern part of the Ukraine was going on not so long as in the western part. As you know, in Galicia, it ended only in the mid-50s. But from 54 to 49, even in Kharkiv, there have been underground groups of the UPA and UN, and they have been or there is a memorial remembering these people. So the most peaceful time in the city was the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. It was the most stable and time of reconstruction. In the end, of course, ending in a time of stagnation. But there are other memorials too in this park. We have a memorial for the victims of the Afghanistan war of the end 70s and early 80s. And we have an entirely new memorial for the so-called liquidators of the Chernobyl disaster. And this is not the final memorial. The final and last memorial is for the holy heroes who have been fallen in the Maidan rebellion of last year, and people who have been killed by anti-Maidan people in March 1914, who resisted a takeover by pro-Russian separatist people in the city of Kharkiv, and for four people who have been killed in February this year, when there was a commemorative march taking place, and where was an explosion of a bomb by so-called pro-Russian partisans. So, what I want to say is that I do not know so many places of the 20th century where you have a sequence, an uninterrupted sequence of layers of disasters, of catastrophe, of disasters. And the problem for the Ukraine and for every historian, including myself, is how a nation, how historiography can come how we can cope, how we can come to terms with this entanglement of suffering, contested history of entirely different fates of different social, ethnic, religious, etc. groups. In the Soviet time, there was a kind of amnesia, of organized silence. There was an official cult of course, of the heroes of the Soviet Union, of the great patriotic war, silencing the suffering of the people. And only in the 60s, 70s, there started a process of remembering. For instance, the first convention, the first meeting commemorating the Babi Yar genocide in Kiev was taking place in the anniversary in 61, organized by some dissidents of the 60s. And there was no commemoration of the Shoah. It was the place where the fascists killed Soviet citizens, but there was no specific commemoration of the fate of the Jewish community on the territory of the Ukraine. The question is so complicated, I would say, that I believe that there is no simple answer. And all this memory war, which is going on about who is a hero, who is a collaborationist, who is a victim of whom, who is and sometimes victims are at the same time or a little bit earlier the perpetrators, or vice versa, perpetrators became victims. So the situation is In German, we have a word which I like very much because I don't know in English, Heillos. We have no words to describe the paradoxes of these fates, but of course historiography has to come to terms with this. And I think it will take a long time, and there is no solution in decreeing to say, now we have cleared everything. And I think the decision made by the Ukrainian cultural ministry 3 weeks ago to define what is Ukrainian history during World War II, it's a fatal blow against real reworking and trying to understand what this history has been. And I think it will take a lot of time of Ukrainian, Russian, German, Polish historians, Jewish historians, to find a language and to find the tone. The tone makes the music in German, to describe this. But war, the ongoing war now, is one of the worst conditions for a relaxed addressing of the past and the history. It's fueling new passions. It's fueling new oppositions and antagonisms and clashes of memory. So it's very hard for the Ukrainian society under the pressure of these unbelievable hate-speeching Russian propaganda. It's unbelievable, complicated, 30 kilometers from the border, 1 hour train travel to the new border of the occupied zone, to find a language to articulate what has been Ukrainian or Kharkiv historian in the 20th century. So my hope is that somehow, I don't know how, I hope soon there will be some silence and peace come, and that historians will take up this challenge of unsolved historiography. So thank you very much for your attention, and if you are interested, probably I did not address all the questions you have or you had, but I'm ready to try to answer what you are asking me. Thank you.